Hey everyone, welcome to episode 33 of the PC World Show. This is your home for tough talk about the most interesting tech topics of the week. And it's been a long time, but we're back after a hiatus. And we have two executive editors. I'll start with Gordon Ma-ung.
Hello.
Hey, Gordon. And Melissa Riofrio.
Hello.
Hey. And I'm editor-in-chief, John Phillips. So we are recording this episode on November 16th. And you know what? I don't think we're going to do a show before Thanksgiving. So this is the last one before... before December.
So be grateful.
Be grateful. Let's make it a good one. Okay, so we have a really varied mix of topics this week. We're going to start with the Apple book. It's got a name, which I'll share when we get to that segment, but it's a $300 book, so that's crazy. Then we're going to move on to the Acer Swift 7. It's a computer that sacrifices performance for aesthetics and portability. And then we're going to go all in on Facebook and talk about its fake news problem. And then finally, I have a writer wrong that asks these two about how big is too big. And so, you know what? They don't even know what I'm going to be asking. They have no prepping. So hopefully we'll catch them off guard.
It's like prime rib. You can't have too big a prime rib. I'm guessing that's it.
Oh, I'll be interested to see where you go with this answer. I know it's going to be a good one. Okay, but let's start with the Apple book. So I want to share the full name of this tome. It's called Designed by Apple in California. It's $300, and it's a big picture book of all of Apple's products. It's a look at Apple product design. So my questions to you two and to the audience at home is any book worth $300? Is any book about Apple products worth $300? What does this say about what Apple thinks of its audience?
Well, what impressed me is that the book documents the creation, it says, of the 1998 iMac through the 2015 Apple Pencil. And it took 8 years to make this book.
And you know,
sounds like you're impressed.
I'm not sure. I think it's like, really? This is all you had to do?
You mean you're afraid they may not upgrade this book for another 4 or 8 years? Is that what you're saying?
You're right. You're right.
Or Gordon, like Gordon always whips out a knife when he opens anything. Maybe you have to have maybe you need a special like book opener to actually get past the wrapping.
I think you do, because also inside you have specially milled custom dyed paper with gilded matte silver edges, which how can you gild something that's silver? Shouldn't that be silvered? Using 8 color separations and low ghost ink, whatever that is. I mean, this is
so
precious.
So Apple. I mean, is this real? Are we sure this isn't part of the fake news story on Facebook we're going to talk about later?
It's real, but everyone is making fun of it like it's an Onion story.
The Onion could not make this more of a real story, could they?
Well, the problem is that, I mean, Gordon and I have built our careers on harshing on Apple constantly about how full of themselves they are. And then they make this book. I mean, like, I can't even make a joke about this. They actually reinforced our impression that they think they're awesome.
It is a reinforcement. And now I know where it's coming from. And that's the belief that our products are beautiful. People who buy these kinds of books like big, beautiful design. And so the book itself is a design piece. And then the products inside, if you believe that they're design pieces, then the whole thing is sort of like a celebration of design, right?
Fine. I like design. Just one company, a book about itself.
Do you think that they're going to include everything though? Like everything? Like the remember the laptop they made that looked like a toilet seat cover?
Well, they started in 1998. So they obviously missed a few things cuz Apple had been around at least 14 or 15 years prior.
I don't know who tweeted it, but someone tweeted, are they going to include all the adapters and dongles?
Do you need actually a special adapter or dongle to read this book? I'm wondering, because that would be the Apple way to do it, right? I mean, how could you charge? The thing that gets me is like, It's like, what I really want to say is the book is designed by Apple in California and printed in China, right? How could you charge?
Do we know it's printed China?
Oh, come on. It's not printed in the U.S. Not, but I mean, it might as well be for $300.
It could be.
Also, that in California thing, you know, I'm just thinking like California and San Francisco already has a reputation for being, how do you pronounce the word?
Overpriced.
Effete. You know, it's like, oh, it's from California. Now it all comes together. And I live in California.
I just don't. I mean, $300?
Well, for those of you on a budget, there is a smaller size version that is only $200.
Yeah, but I think they had an internal debate at Apple. Like, look, this is the right size book. And then they're like, they spent years debating, like, we should make a bigger book. No. This is the perfect size. Only make it one way. No, make the bigger version. And they decided to make the bigger version.
I do know that large format books do cost disproportionately more than smaller books for whatever reason. Yeah, it has to do with the 8-up or 16-up way you do the web.
Sure. Especially when you go to Barnes & Noble's and you can get the same size book with the same amount of pages for $8.
The thing is, it's not even that big. Like, what are the dimensions?
We got it.
But you know what I mean. You go into Barnes & Noble's and you're browsing. It's like, hey, look at this. It's a book about all the tanks ever made. And it's like hardcover.
I know.
There's
like
500
$8.99.
$8.99. Yeah. So, I'm buying this for my dad.
Like weapons weapons of world history. I'll buy that.
Yeah.
You know, it'd be perfect. Or it's like, you know, geography book. I'll buy that. They're cool.
So the large one is 13 by 16.25 inches.
So that's small. I mean, okay. So I was in a Barnes & Noble or a Borders, and I saw this book on Muhammad Ali. It was a huge format book. It was like that.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, that's cool. I just liked it from a design perspective. It was $300. It was the same price, but you got more paper.
So cheaper by the pound is what you're saying. And then the smaller one is basically 10 by 12.
That's small. That's smaller than an album.
No.
Than an old LP.
I'm just getting some breaking news. I'm breaking news at this moment. HP and Dell are also introducing picture books, but these picture books will be larger, give you more pages, and higher resolution printing, and cost half as much. Yes, I'm making that up. There's not really happening.
This is one where I really want to hear from the Facebook audience to see if they have an
opinion.
They're
all going to buy it.
Adam, do we have anybody who's chimed in?
Everyone that's chimed in has said, heck no.
Oh, come on.
They're definitely not going to buy it. Yeah. Sorry.
So we're finding out where the level of Apple trolling works for the PC world audience. Is what product was it that Gordon was going off on? Or is like, oh, this guy's being too harsh.
I can't remember. Maybe the iPhone 7?
Was it iPhone 7?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, do you mean the no earplug
the no
thing?
Yeah.
Well, earphone.
The earpods.
Earpods.
So yeah. I haven't talked to the Macworld staff yet. Do they have any intention of buying it, or does anyone have a...
I think everybody's really like, it's. They really have to a really $300 book, just with like, I mean, they're beautiful pictures. It's probably printed beautifully in China for $300. Who the hell is going to buy this? And then what I want to know is these coffee table books. Do you guys have coffee tables? Do you guys really have the coffee table?
I have coffee table books on it. Yeah.
Really? Like,
well, I don't have kids. Maybe that's why the difference is like,
I'm just trying to think. I
don't have toys on.
What do you do with do people come over and like, they want to sit down and talk to you? Like, don't talk to me. Just read this book instead. I don't.
Well, it's exactly what Apple is going for. The book itself is a curio. It's a piece of art.
Yeah. Right.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. But you know, I have on my coffee table, I have books about like sports car design, and I have a book about from the Museum of Modern Art, and I do like leafing through it, you know, every now and then, once a year, once every 5 years.
Okay, so it's a real thing. I didn't know that.
Coffee table books are real.
They are a real thing.
And they're also giftable.
Oh yes.
So there's that. But no one's going to gift a $300 book. So
well, I'm going to get it at Barnes & Noble's when it's $8.99.
Does Barnes & Noble's exist?
Well, yes, yeah, they're still around.
They're physical storefronts.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, but you go in and they got the section of the big picture books for $8.99. So
it's true.
It won't take long to get this there, right?
I think you'll be waiting a long time.
It's only at the.
By the way,
only at Apple.
I'm just
stores.
Waiting for the Apple coloring book. You know, you just color in the products. Oh. Yeah, there you go.
Or you get the $300 book and your kid starts drawing on it. All the pages were white. There was plenty of room. I was helping the book.
I would be disappointed if they left out all the ugliness, though, right? Because Apple has made plenty of really just like what.
Right.
The?
That's a good point. Like over time, the old stuff looks really dated.
Oh, it looks, it's just
the original iMac.
Not even dated. It looks like, whoa, what were you? They're like bell bottom pants, you know, like, but not just bell bottom pants. We're talking like you, like Clipper ship bell bottom pants, right? I mean, that's, it was just ugly. Some of those Apple products are just horrible. At the time, I guess.
Well, but let's be fair. A lot of PC products are ugly.
Yeah, that too. Beige but box. I mean, HP people, I mean, PC people don't get all like, you know, like, oh, we designed the best thing.
All full of ourselves.
I mean, everything eventually looks like, you know, the 80s and the Nero ties and, you know, I guess.
It's back again. Anyway, let's move on. So there's a very specific computer we want to talk about. I guess we gave it a verdict already. It's been reviewed.
We did.
Okay, so let's look at this computer.
So let's pull
Tell
it
us
up.
About it. What
this
is
the Acer Swift 7. Basically, it seems like, oh wait, yeah, this is it.
That's
I grabbed
it.
The right one, right? Jesus, got too many laptops here. It's the Acer Swift 7. It's basically, and if you remember the S7, which was really a pretty awesomely thin laptop at the time, I think really this is sort of a replacement for it. But, you know, they're calling it Swift 7, which is a great name for it. It's got a Core i7 inside, but, you know, it's really just the rebadged version of the Core M part. And the big deal is...
Can you turn the keyboard around?
I'll turn
so
the keyboard.
It
is, quite beautiful. It is a beautiful laptop. For people who cannot see this, I'm holding basically a really nice looking... Ultrabook. It's super thin, and it is...
If you like the gold, but yeah.
If you like the gold.
The thinness.
Is it only available in gold?
I think this is the only color, which
well,
is a black and
but
gold,
the,
I think.
But the deal is that this is currently the world's thinnest laptop.
Right, they're saying thinnest, which, you know, is debatable among among other people, but it's, I think we measured it at 9.9 millimeters right here at the hinge,
yeah.
Which is pretty good. So the... You know, and our review, which Elena wrote, ran this morning, her problem is like, it's like, God, you know, I understand thin is kind of good, but have you gone too far? I mean, like, really?
Yeah.
What the next size up in HP is the Spectre 13.3, which I'm also holding next to it. It's maybe, you know, like, oh, half a millimeter.
Just a few
thicker.
Millimeters.
Dig in for the audience. So everyone likes thin, but... At the expense of what?
Right. So you're giving up on that. This is the Acer S Swift 7. It's got a Core M, basically. I mean, it is a Core. Intel calls it a Core i7. It's a Kaby Lake Core M processor, fanless. So, you know, you're not going to get all the performance you're going to get out of this Spectre 13.3, which has a fan in its older Skylake processor. And in fact, even though it's Skylake, it's still faster because it's got a fan, right? It's a 15-watt part versus a 5-watt part. So you do give up performance... For it, I mean, there's no Thunderbolt 3 in the Acer.
Yeah.
HP has Thunderbolt 3, and I think one of the issues I have, as well as the Spectre. I mean, I love the Spectre because you're getting a lot of performance. It's super thin. It's, you know, got that interesting gold look to it. Is like the proportions. It's thin, but it's still so wide.
Wait a second.
Like
are we writing an Apple book here? I think the thing for me is the performance.
The Apple book's too thick. They should have made it thinner.
The thing for me is the performance and that, you know, everyone loves the thinner notebooks, but as you get thinner and thinner, thermals become a huge issue.
Right.
And so what we've noticed the vendors doing over the last few years really is that they throttle the processor to keep the heat down. And so then your performance goes down.
Right.
So your laptop's nice and thin, it's lighter, but it's not quite as fast as it actually promises to be in under certain circumstances.
So where do you guys fall? Would you rather have thin or would you rather have the performance? Because in many cases, you don't need the performance. You might rather have thin.
That's totally true. I mean, I think as PC people, we always want to have faster, 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 faster. But this is a trade-off, a very clear trade-off.
Right.
You know, because probably the faster notebook is going to weigh, 4 or 5 pounds? If you're talking about one of the gaming laptops with discrete graphics and all that stuff, it's going to have vents going everywhere, fans going everywhere, but it's going to weigh a ton and you're not going to bring it to a trade show.
Yeah, and I think when you make your purchasing decisions, like I'm a desktop at home and a notebook on the road kind of person.
Mm-hmm.
So and I'm not going to, the way I travel, I'm not gaming. I'm not doing anything other than... you know, just email or social media or working, which means using our CMS. So I could see a notebook like that would work for me, but it's definitely not a do everything notebook.
No.
Because you're going to, you know, I'm not going to be doing intense Photoshop editing. on that.
Yeah. Like for me, my thing is the proportion. So this is, you know, of course, it's a larger 13-inch screen. I'm also in my right hand, I'm holding the ASUS ZenBook 3, which is basically a clone of the MacBook 12, except the keyboard actually has travel in it. and I actually like the proportion. I like the form factor. This is also very thin. You know, it's really tiny. And it's pretty light. You throw this in your backpack. You really don't know it's there. The Acer and the Spectre are both, you know, you're going to feel them in your backpack. And then it's just, it's
But don't you
thin,
always want more
still,
screen?
Yeah. It's tough, right? Because you always want the largest screen you can that weighs nothing.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can have two things and one of them you got to leave out. So I don't know. I like small laptops that I can bring.
Yeah. I mean, I think the question for our audience is, do you want thin or do you want fast?
Yeah. I mean, like look, this is the classic, Dell XPS 13, right?
Yeah.
Same size screen, got no bezel. It's got a smaller footprint, but it's thick. I mean, it's a thick. But, you know, I got to say, do I really care if it's 3 millimeters thicker? I mean, why is that going to bug me, you know?
I care more about the weight than the thickness.
Yes. Yeah. So if the weight is kind of similar, I think the Acer is a little bit lighter, but not that much. And then the Dell is all over it in performance because it's got fans, it's thicker. But to me, the Dell's a good size. It's a really good compromise between the ZenBook 3 and the Acer and the Spectre.
Let's turn it over to the audience. So Melissa posed the question, what would you rather have? So let's see if there's any responses on that. Also, are there any questions on the Acer?
Everyone that chimed in so far is saying they'll take performance. They'll take a fat laptop that performs well. But we do have a good question from, Ollie? He says, which is the thinnest and most powerful laptop that you would advise to buy?
Of this batch that I have here, and probably it would be this. If you're looking for, again, you want super thin, it would be this HP Spectre 13.3. Yeah. Core i7 Skylake part. I'm sure they're going to roll it to Kaby Lake, but, you know, fan, 15 watts. It's pretty, it's reasonably fast. If you're looking for performance and just, well, I guess for thin, I don't know. I guess the next step up is the Spectre X360, which I am reviewing. HP, Ken, I am going to review it. I just have been too busy. So
promises.
This is Spectre X360, which I really love. This is, you know, John, you have the previous version. You have the first generation. It is a great laptop, and you get touch, you're getting Windows Hello. It's actually pretty thin. It's thinner than the XPS 13.
Yeah, definitely.
Definitely thinner. I mean,
I like the logo.
It's like almost half the thickness. Well, not quite half. Maybe 3/4 of the thickness of an XPS 13. You get a Core i7 Kaby Lake in here. It's pretty fast. So.
And what about pricing?
Pricing, these are all roughly $1,100 laptops. Of course, you can go up, you can go down if you want bigger SSDs, more RAM, that kind of stuff.
Cool. God, so many computers. People are still making computers.
Yes, it's nice. It's nice. People, apparently, the analysts were wrong, and people still want PCs and computers and laptops.
What was the
I should be an analyst.
Some manufacturer has been using the PC World name on their ads recently. TV ads.
Really?
I think it's HP.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Huh.
I can't remember where it was appearing. Might have been during Walking Dead, but... yeah, I wish I could remember the name of the manufacturer, but yeah, not only are they making the laptops still, they're also advertising them for nationwide primetime audiences.
So. I was just thinking of the audience for that. Like, we need the Walking Dead audience. Like, really? Okay, I guess
everybody's the Walking Dead audience.
I've stopped watching. It's
getting dark, but it's good. Okay, so let's just do a Walking Dead show.
We should
better than Chris Hardwick.
Yeah. we got Adam. He could shoot it, you know?
Okay. Well, let's move on to the third topic. So we had an election. A lot of news stories and opinions have come out of it. But in the technology sphere, the big story is Facebook's fake news. So... they're taking a lot of flack for allowing and to fake news appear on their sites. And I guess teenagers in Macedonia were creating a lot of the fake news, in essence, to make money. They weren't politically motivated. They just wanted it for the clicks. So,
yes.
Tell us about this. Like, Melissa,
I can give a little background on it. So Mark Zuckerberg was speaking at a conference last week where this topic came up, and he brushed off the idea that fake news surfacing on Facebook had affected the election. And then over the weekend, he wrote a post on his Facebook page kind of going into that in more depth and saying, you know, whatever, 99% or 90% of the news you see on Facebook is totally legit. This isn't an issue. But at the same time now, since then, Facebook is saying we're changing our policies so that we can, you know, minimize fake news, and Google and Twitter are also getting into it and saying they're trying to keep you away from fake news sites. But one of the issues is, what's fake news? You know, and I think as journalists, we're always worried about free speech and people being able to say whatever they want. And so, you know, how are these, you know, social networks deciding what's legit and what's not?
Yeah. And there's also the issue that I think over 40% of Americans say their primary news source is Facebook. So obviously Facebook doesn't have reporters or journalists, but they're a platform for other people's news. So if you're if instead of going to CNN or a left-leaning website or a right-leaning website, and you're just going to Facebook for your news, you're going to get much more news because you have, you know, obviously all these different sources. But the way the algorithm works is it could be weighted towards one direction or another. So it could be highly partisan, depending on what you've decided to like on your Facebook page. And then also there's just the issue of that a lot of that news just could be completely inaccurate.
Yeah. But so what I want to know is, how is this news being surfaced? Because, I mean, I understand if someone takes a story, wherever the source, and then they share it, then you see it in your timeline, I think they call it.
You could.
What we're talking about? Or are we talking about the stuff that just comes on the side that nobody reads?
No, we're talking about the stuff in the timeline. It's all algorithmically, you know, determined. And I don't know exactly how it works, but I'll tell you, I mean, I've never liked Facebook. I mean, I just find it annoying, and it's more annoying than ever because you go back to your newsfeed the next day and it's the same stuff from the day before. And it seems to like favor of like, very few people on my feed. I don't know. I mean, they're not, definitely not all friends, but I have like about 300 friends. Mm-hmm. And it seems like, why did it pick that person? I never talked to that person. I don't even click on that person's stuff. And it's really, so the algorithm seems to be getting more narrow, and it's, that I do not understand, but do you have any insights?
Well,
on
it's
that?
Always annoyed me that Facebook is using any kind of algorithm to decide what I want to see anyway. Like, I was perfectly happy when I just saw everything and I could ignore it if I wanted to. And suddenly they're saying, well, based on what you've liked or shared or looked at or lingered on, we're going to show you this stuff and you may never see the other stuff.
Yeah.
You know, that just bothers me in general. And
unless it's this podcast long.
And what also
right,
bothers
and they,
me.
And they goose that too, because when something, sorry, but when something, right. when something goes live, you everyone gets an alert saying, jump in, it's live. And so that's another way for people to, you know, basically game the system.
Well, and what also bothers me, and then I'll get off my soapbox, is that Google and Facebook and Twitter all blame the algorithm. Well, it's the algorithm, you know, we're not really responsible, but hello, humans wrote that algorithm. And however they can deny that they're not a media company or not a news company, this is the content that they're surfacing on their site. And I think at some point they need to take some responsibility.
Right. And that's the real tension there, is they're a group of engineers and they want to be able to say, like, we're not a news platform. We don't do any editorializing. It's all completely, you know, beyond our control. If you've seen the latest Westworld, you have to wonder.
Yeah.
But and so they're getting off, for lack of a better term, scot-free, you know, on that particular point. But the bottom line is that they, you know, I saw it on Facebook, must be true. That's the kind of criticism that they have to deal with. And I think they have to face that music.
Yeah. Melissa and I were talking about this earlier, and my opinion is I very much have a problem with who is defining what news is, or what's fake, what's not fake. So fake news, some kid in Macedonia making up a story to get clicks to his website, saying crazy things like, hey, the president just showed us the flying saucers at Area 51. Is that fake news? Yeah, probably fake news. A mainstream USA Today or New York Times story where the reporter just really blew it. It happens to every news organization. They just screwed up. They got bad sources. They came, you know, and the story is clearly bad, right? Terrible story, poorly sourced, you know, not fair at all. Is that fake news? You know?
Well, and here's another angle. They talk about, you know, how fake news could be, you know, manipulating people's minds. Last time I checked, gullible people have existed for as long as people have existed. Like, there's a sucker born every minute. It means maybe social media makes the deception move faster.
Yeah.
But it's been around all of our existence.
And I think it's the speed that, I agree with you, but it's the speed at which it's moving that is causing a lot of the problems, where when people only had newspapers or TV, and you probably got yourself in a regular rhythm, and you read the newspaper pretty much every day.
Yeah.
Or, you know, the general populace did. And so through word of mouth, they could almost fact check each other. But now when stuff is moving so quickly, bam, you're on to the next thing, and you're not going to read that retraction to the mistake that the USA Today reporter made.
Right.
So yeah, social media creates a lot of problems.
Well, you know, I think the thing is, people just, and every time I see these things and I go, oh, that's interesting, and I'm going to do more research. Maybe it's just because who I am. And then it's like, man, you are so full of it. This is like totally fake, right? I mean, you know, everybody should just get in the habit of doing that. I mean, I don't understand how you train people to be skeptical of everything they read, but I mean, there must be some way we can get people to.
That's kind of our job as journalists.
Yes, but I mean, just as the general public themselves should be like, I mean, honestly, if I write something and I say something, you know, hey, don't trust me. Read it somewhere else. There's a different opinion. Form your own opinion. Don't believe everything I say. Right?
It's like when we write reviews, which are absolutely 100% subjective opinion, unless we're doing benchmarks, then there's some empirical evidence. And so people go, you're wrong. Well, it's like, well, no, I had an opinion about this product, and that's my opinion. You should read 100 different reviews and get other people's opinions.
Yeah. And, you know, I've seen reviews that you just go like, my God, this person really, really had it wrong. Right.
Yeah.
So, you know, and sometimes there are politics to reviews too, but I mean, yeah, don't read everybody's reviews and form your own opinion. Right.
Yeah. And don't just look at one side, and that's my opinion. That applies whether you lean to the left or the right, you have to look at the other side. But now I want to look at the side of the viewers and the audience. Do they have any thoughts on this or questions?
John, they're saying watch out for the spoilers on Westworld and Walking Dead. You know?
What?
I've already read a little bit farther in the comic book, and I don't know anything about the Westworld canon, so I'm cool there.
No, and Sharonda is saying she's not quite sure, so Oprah's not pregnant, is it?
Wait, is Oprah pregnant? I saw
she read some fake news.
That would be
that could be a medical miracle. Yeah. Any questions on the Facebook front?
Not other than Oprah.
All right.
I did not know that.
Well, thanks for indulging us on this fake news stuff. But any last thoughts before we jump to the secret right or wrong?
I'm still thinking about that Apple book, honestly. I just...
You're going to buy it, aren't you?
That's like, I think Apple is just like, this is not real. Do you think people believe it? Yeah, put it out anyway. It's like, it's probably not even real.
It sounds like it would make a great display stand.
They're just messing with us.
$300 display stand. So, throughout the show, it seems like there's a theme that's developing about size. Like, it's this huge Apple book. It's got a huge price. It's got these big or thin notebook. So I want to unveil this.
Holy smokes.
This is Fab 2 Pro. It's the first Project Tango phone. This is a phone. This is from Lenovo. And this is the phone that enables Google's Project Tango, which is essentially augmented reality on a phone. So my question to you guys is, let's just pick it up for... Well, actually, I'll hold it up next to the Pixel. So the Pixel is... this is in a case.
And that's the XL, right?
This is a Pixel XL, which is 5.5 inches. And that's...
How big is that screen, man?
This is 6.4-inch screen. 6.4-inch. I haven't even turned it on. We just got it today. But this is Lenovo's Fab 2 Pro, Project Tango. So my question to you guys is, at 6.4 inches... Is the Fab 2 Pro a tablet, right or wrong? Actually, I screwed up my old right or wrong. Right or wrong, it's a tablet, right or wrong.
Can I hold it?
Yeah.
May I hold it?
Yeah, we got the Lenovo.
Yeah, we got the little logo.
Looks like the Levi's logo. What's up with that?
It's a tablet, at least for my hand.
But it does calls.
It does make phone calls.
So it's a phone.
It does have phone capability, but as far as size, and by the way, you know, I'm all for bigger phones because I like having the bigger screen size. This might be a little hard for me to carry, and actually feels a little heavy.
It's heavy. Yeah.
Yeah. But, So I would call it a tablet. Is that what I said before? I think that is.
You did say. So right or wrong, this is a tablet, Gordon.
Wrong. It's a phone. Because, look, I'm talking on it. So it's a phone. And, you know, and also it passes the back. You can put it in your back pocket.
Does it?
Yeah, sure. I can almost get a Nexus 7.
We need a visual on that,
Gordon. It did fit in my front pocket.
We need a visual.
Yeah, it fits. Look, look. I'm going to stand up. Look, back pocket.
It sticks out.
That's a huge back pocket.
They're not hipster pants. Hipster pants, no. You could not fit an iPhone SE in the back pocket of hipster pants. But, man, and of course, I was the opposite of this earlier, but it's like, wow, this. I like the, actually how big it is, but could they make it thinner?
Yeah.
I mean, it just feels like this. The proportion is like, man, this sucker's thick.
It's really big.
It's just thick. I mean, the screen size, I don't mind.
So you got a tablet and a phone.
Yeah, it's a phone. You can talk on it. You can still fit in your back pocket. That fits in a breast pocket. Fits. It'll fit in my purse. I mean, anything,
here,
right?
I need to see it again.
I'd say it's a phone, but it is untenable. This is not a phone you're going to be walking around with.
Yeah, Florida sure. Everybody said that when the note came out. You know, actually, the funny thing is, I think I found a really old Dell. Do you remember the old Dell 5-inch?
Yeah, I did a review. That was like the first tablet I reviewed. It was 5 inches.
It was forever ago, right?
Streak? The Dell?
Yeah, the Dell Streak.
Yeah.
And people were like, man, do you even know what you're doing, Dell? And of course, like years later, it's like, yeah, what? 5-inch phone? That's tiny.
Well, they marketed it as a tablet, though, so it was a small tablet compared to the iPad, which was already up.
But still, I gotta say, it's I could see it. I mean, if it's fast, and we're getting to the point where the funny thing is, phones are killing tablet sales, and people want bigger screens.
And that's why I have a 5.5-inch phone. It's like, I don't have to jump to the tablet when I want to just browse on the couch.
Yeah, I mean, the sad thing is my phone outperforms my tablets, so that's
there's that too.
Yeah.
So I mean, yeah,
tablets.
And after that whole Acer thing, I just can't believe I'm saying this, but yeah, it would be just a little bit thinner, because once you put the case on there,
oh my god, it's so big.
It's like you're going to be calling in for an airstrike with this.
Well, has everyone seen your phone? And is that an OtterBox case or whatever you have on?
I wish I could get an OtterBox, but they don't make this. So this is which one is this?
That's the 6P.
It's a 6P. They don't make an OtterBox for it. It's just
but that's pretty chunky.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Once you put the cover on.
Well, with an OtterBox, it'd be even thicker.
Yeah.
The Defender. I usually buy the Defender, which is, a massive piece of rubber, and you could throw it against walls, but they don't make it for the 6P, which I guess tells you how well the 6P did, right? So
did we do a PC World show on the Pixel?
Yeah, we did. I think so. Did we? I don't know.
News came out,
because it already cracked.
I don't know if the camera can get this. I actually did drop it on the sixth drop. The back cracked.
Oh no!
Oh no!
This was before the very first case was available. So now I have a case. Sorry for hitting the mic. I got the case 3 days after I broke the back.
Oh my god.
That's totally lame, but it still works. But yeah, the glass back breaks.
Yeah, well, that's why you don't put more glass on a phone. Yeah. Apple, of course, they stopped doing that with the 5, right? Because original 4 was glass in the back, which kind of looked cool, but come on,
cool.
That's just like increasing your breakage.
Now it's aluminium.
So, Sammy, I know we usually don't turn to Facebook on this.
We're just rambling at this point.
Yeah, but, he says, I'm editorializing here. Can't we all just get along and call it a phablet?
Look at that sucker,
well,
man.
It is a phablet now. Okay, I'm cool with that. What's his name? Sammy?
Sammy,
I'm cool with that. Let's call it a phablet, but now we have to call the Notes, the Pixel XL, just regular phones. Like Greenbot has to stop calling those size phones phablets, because everything's moved upward. Damn, that's big.
It's huge.
But I think we just call them all phones. I mean, honestly, I'm not even sure I agree with the phablet thing.
So you're saying as long as it has phone capability, it's a phone.
Right.
If it's got a SIM card.
Well, see, you can have a laptop with a SIM card, but you're not going to hold it up against your face and talk, right? You can use Bluetooth. You can use all the other, headphone and stuff, but that doesn't make it a phone. These are still primarily phones, because you're going to press them up against your head.
Well, what about a FaceTime audio calling on the iPad?
Yeah, but that's over IP. I mean,
Well, let's take another example. So Sony Walkman versus Boombox. Obviously, huge difference in size, but you put them up listen to them? And so are they both personal audio devices?
Yeah, they're both personal audio devices, but one is, you know, a boombox. I would not call a Sony Walkman a boombox. They're both personal. I don't remember it being this big when I saw it at CES. Look at that.
It was at CES?
Well, they showed something. Remember they had some, I went to the Tango event and they had something
that,
they showed.
That would have been it. Yeah.
But I don't remember it because
well, it does have a lot of extra optics because of the special augmented reality.
Yeah. Maybe that's why it's thicker. How big is the battery? It's gotta be like a laptop battery in here. Holy eight. So, you know, it's unfortunate we can't, for people listening to the podcast and they can't see it, but just imagine, I don't know. It feels like a 7-inch tablet that's a phone almost. It's almost that.
Well, it's
big.
Also really oblong too, I think.
Yeah.
I'm trying.
And thick.
I think the Nexus 7.
Yeah.
Was more square, you know, more. It was broader.
Although the aspect ratio. 4x3, yeah, probably.
It's
yeah,
a big-ass phone.
I actually finally reclaimed my Nexus 7 for my son. I've been using it. It's still a great little tablet, mm-hmm. although they stopped supporting it.
I'm using the Pixel now.
Yeah.
Anyway, that was a fun little tangent off into, we won't call them phablets anymore, we'll just call them phones. Okay, so that has been episode 33 of the PC World Show. Thank you, Melissa.
It was great.
And thanks, Gordon.
See everyone.
See ya. And remember, we're taking next week off. We'll be back in December. So check back then for more tough talk about the most interesting tech topics of the week.